The year was 1959, and I figured in my 10-year-old head that this was probably the most exciting thing my parents had ever done. Our bags were packed, the cooler was full, and we were setting out for a family adventure on the Mother Road, Route 66. Daddy, a salesman, must have had a good year because a few weeks before our vacation, he'd gone out and bought a shiny, new, two-tone aqua and turquoise 1958 Chevy Impala with air conditioning. The only thing he could have done better was to make it a convertible. But had Mr. Frugal made that move, Mama would have canceled the trip and had him committed, certain that he had gone off the deep end. My parents were suddenly displaying a level of cool never before demonstrated to me and sister. We were going to California, the ultimate vacation destination for the 50s. It seemed that everyone living in Arkansas during those post-Dust Bowl, post-war days had a family member transplanted to California who needed to be visited. The phrase, y'all come when you can, every Southerner knows, really just means bye-bye. But nobody said it couldn't be taken literally when the time was right, and that time was now. So we did take Daddy's youngest brother and family literally. He had joined the military during the war and upon discharge made the no-brainer choice of a California lifestyle over a return to the cotton fields of northeast Arkansas. Seems that having smarts runs in our family. He had married and had my cousins, whom we'd seen only once on their brief visit back home, so we figured they needed a visit. Sister and I could barely contain ourselves since our parents agreed to let us visit Disneyland. Fortunately for us back then, a family of modest means could afford the Magic Kingdom without having to choose which kid would have to be sold in order to afford tickets for the rest. Mama had added a curious item to the agenda, a stop in La Jolla for us all to visit her boyfriend before Daddy, whom we had heard about way too much. I'm not sure if Daddy agreed to this because he figured he had held up better in time than Paul and wanted to show off, or if since their marriage was a pretty volatile union, he was in hopes that Paul would take Mama off his hands. Either way, when the time came, it was an awkward situation for us kids. We backed out of the driveway in our cool new ride before daybreak, with the aroma of fried chicken wafting out from under the tablecloth covering the picnic basket. We hadn't made it out of the state before we were all clutching a napkin-wrapped leg, wing, or thigh. By the time we pulled into the roadside park, all we had left was one thigh, a neck, and a gizzard, and a couple of those other gross parts. No such thing as fast food existed, so we had to make do, filling in with Velveeta, Viennese, and potato sticks. After a few hours on the road, the novelty of oil wells and tumbleweeds had worn off. I tortured my family with imitations of the South Texas radio DJs, the fire and brimstone preachers, and cowboy songs sung off-key by my alter ego, Rex Titter. About an hour and a half into my performance, the rude bunch I lived with all yelled at me to stop. My pouting only lasted around 20 miles. Sister and I then resorted to noting license plates and keeping count of cars with and without radiator water bags. Finally, on day three, we arrived at our first tourist attraction, the Petrified Forest. All of us had been victims of our own vivid imaginations and expected a huge forest of petrified trees standing up like our still-living trees in Arkansas. Daddy, who was never easily impressed and never liked to show it when he was, dubbed it the Putrefied Forest. But then this is the man who, when we visited the Grand Canyon the next day, answered Mommy's breathless question, "Well, Bud, what do you think? Isn't that wonderful?" with, "Yep, mighty big hole." Dad's traveling style was to set a daily timetable and to never stray from it. So all we saw of Los Angeles was the freeway in the back of Daddy's head as he held a death grip on the steering wheel to guide the Impala safely through the traffic. Hopes of taking in the glamour of Hollywood and Beverly Hills were not to be. Sister and I soon recovered from that disappointment when we were dropped off at the gates of Disneyland, left on our own to experience the magic while our parents visited Daddy's cousin, another transplant from Arkansas. We were dizzied by repeated rides on the Alice in Wonderland teacups and the discovery of California boys. We had entered the gates of preteen heaven. With Daddy's arrival goals and not much else on the agenda, we finally arrived at Uncle Jay's house in Sacramento, where we got reacquainted with our cousins and the California lifestyle. While the adults reminisced and laughed over grown-up drinks, Sister and I ate supper in the den with the cousins and for the first time had something wonderful and exotic they called pizza pie. We refrained from exchanging cuisines with them, so the extra cans of Vianney stayed hidden in our picnic basket in the car. Daddy was relaxed and in top form the next day when we all set out on a day trip to San Francisco to see the sights and to visit Aunt Ava's mother and aunts. All nine of us managed to fit into Uncle Jay's station wagon, which came to a standstill at the direction of the California Highway Patrol as we neared the city center. Daddy hopped out and approached the group of officers on motorcycles lining the street. We waited to get the scoop on the delay, only to see our good old boy Dad posing with his arms on the shoulders of two of California's finest. He saluted his new friends and goose-stepped his way back to the car to report that our trip was delayed by a high-ranking Soviet diplomat who was preceding Premier Khrushchev's visit in September. Later that day, Daddy went on to either charm or totally confuse an elderly Chinese-American man when we visited Chinatown. Daddy bought a Chinese newspaper and parked himself up against a lamppost, seemingly engrossed in reading the news of the day. The old gentleman circled Dad a couple of times, looked up at his red Scots-Irish face, and asked, astonished, in broken English, "You read Chinese?" To which Daddy drawled, "Oh, sure. I see here that a real important Russian fellow's in town." We kids had the run of the town when our cousins gave us a tour of the city. Later, we wore our coats and drank hot chocolate on a July night while we watched the newly transplanted Giants play at Candlestick Park. The pitcher got called for a balk when the wind blew him off the mound. Time to say goodbye to our relatives came way too fast, and we hit the road again, this time taking the northern route home. Daddy hit trip mode and Mama entered her "the fun is over" funk at the same moment. The chemistry was explosive. Dad was determined to stop for nothing and Mama was determined to let the good times play on. The result was an argument so hot that it took Sister and me years to get over. The conflict centered on Mama's insistence that we take a side trip to Yosemite and Daddy's insistence that we get home. The yelling went on for miles and miles and got louder and louder while we covered our ears in the back seat. Then Mama went for all-out drama, opening the car door and threatening to jump while we careened through curvy mountain roads. Daddy, a man not known for patience, somehow kept from swerving just a tiny bit more at that point. Either God answered our pleas from the back seat or Dad realized he would have a lot of explaining to do if he returned home minus a wife. Somehow that car door was closed with Mama still inside. Since Daddy held the steering wheel and therefore all of the cards, we did not see Yosemite, and I never have. After driving endless miles through Kansas, we were hungry for the green hills of home. So Daddy, Sister, and I voted to drive through the night while Mama pouted. Daddy had us sing with him for hours to keep him awake for the rest of the trip. Finally, in the wee hours, with our heads full of the wonders of the West, we crossed the bridge into Little Rock, and Daddy belted out a solo. Something about when he was a baby, rocking in a cradle, and them old cotton fields back home.